and sometimes as they ought to be. So this is the question of education. Discovering the rule of society best suited to nations would require a superior intelligence that beholds the passions of men without feeling any of them, who had no affinity with our nature, yet knew it through and through. In other words, it requires the great legislator, the someone who's outside our world, who can look at it and say, here's what people need, not necessarily what they want. If, of course, you have people educated the way that Neil was educated, but people are ignorant, people are stupid, you know, so they need to have somebody in the first place to help set down these laws so that the general will then can accustom itself to participating in society. So this is, his prototype is Lycurgus, the king, the lawgiver of Sparta, and of course the father. Really, for the state, he looks to Lycurgus, who promoted the virtues of equality, military fitness, austerity, everybody had equal amounts of land, and they all ate together, the education was communal, the vote, all citizens had voted and so forth. They didn't have slaves, and so he says, maybe we need slaves to be free. So legislation brings about institutions and changes human nature, makes people part of the larger whole, and provides belief. You have to deny man his own forces in order to give him back forces that are alien to him, and that he cannot make use of without the help of others. So alone, we don't have power. Together, we do. When each citizen is nothing and can do nothing, except in concert with all the others. So a private will can only become general, submitted to the vote of people, but how to convince and communicate common people who don't understand. So you can't use force and you can't use reason, and this is the most controversial part of Rousseau. He says, the great leader can trick people. He can lie to them, because he has higher reason. He has sublime reason. And this is why the first states are all theocracies. Because the leader always says that his knowledge comes from God, or gods. It's brought down to him. He's not an ordinary human being. He speaks to people as a prophet, or as God on earth. So he says, the compulsion is by divine authority. Those whom human prudence could not move. Divine authority can move people who are reluctant to accept the word of another man. This is, he says, the product of wisdom, genius, and the lawgiver Lycurgus is the example, who didn't rule, who gave the laws and then stepped aside. And funnily enough, in Swat, it's the same thing. Sheikh Mali, the guy who brought all the people that I worked with into the valley where I was, he was a religious man. He gave the rules by religion. They were very similar, everybody equal, and he's rotated. The citizens were all the members of the tribe, and he didn't rule. So this has to be done with paying attention to the capacities of the people. Now here he talks about the problems of ruling. Some people are corrupted. They can't be ruled. They cannot fathom a just rule. Sometimes the society is deteriorating, so only revolution can cure it. That's very unusual. Once the chain of the general will and sovereignty is broken, it can't be remade. This sounds like a New Hampshire relief. Henceforth, a master is needed, not a liberator. Liberty can be acquired, but it can never be recovered. Live free or die. So social bonds are stronger in a small state than they came from Geneva, but it makes sense. Montesquieu says the same thing. Connections are weaker in large states, the leader is too distant, administration is far away and multiple. The differences between customs of citizens in a large state may be too different to maintain the general will. expansion leads to inefficiency, alienation, financial failure. Think about the USA. The problem with small states is that they're easily conquered. The problem with big states is they tend to become tyrannies. You also have to have, like he says, sufficient land, but you shouldn't really have too much because that allows for conquest. And you have to keep in mind the legislative and the general will of the sovereign has to keep in mind the natural resources and capacities of that community. So you shouldn't have very deeply rooted customs in order to become a just state, because what you have to do is develop conventions and opinions and well, the general will, as Rousseau calls it, our cultural world, so unconsciously, it has to be developed by the gathering together of people under the influence of somebody who has the knowledge, and then beginning to be part of our understanding of the world we're in. So, what makes the work of legislation trying is not so much what must be established as that which must be destroyed. Because whatever was there before has to be gotten rid of during the new world. So what are the objects of legislation? Liberty and equality. Everybody should maybe not be the same, but there shouldn't be big excesses of wealth or poverty. And must live in accord with the same in the nature of things, kinds of law. Except that the kind of law, he says there's four kinds of law, but the most important law is what he called mores. That's what I was trying to think of. Mores. What are mores? Mores is, he says, that which is engraved in the hearts of citizens. And speaking of mores, custom, and especially opinion, on which depends the success of all the others. So you have a law that people do not find in their hearts. It's not part of their general opinion cycle. It's not part of their mores. That law will not be obeyed. So you cannot just impose laws on people if you want to have a just society. The mores are the secret occupation of the legislature. Regulation is the arching of the vaults, mores and the keystone. Convention, he says it at the very beginning, conventions are crucial. Written laws, statements, documents, and so on are only valid insofar as they speak to the mores of the people, what the people think the world should be, and what they think their relationships with the world should be. Now, government, what is it? Government, what is it? Government is between the subject and the subject. Government is the intermediate body between the subjects and the sovereign. The members, the kings and the magistrates, the government administrates executive power, receives from the sovereign orders and gives to the people, who are themselves sovereign on the one hand and subjects on the other. Remember? Everybody is part of the sovereign as far as you're a citizen. Subject insofar as we are subject to the laws of the sovereign. The sovereign is not a person, the sovereign is this collective will and body. So, remember, king, ruler, is a technical term. So he rules according to laws established by the nation, and he can be deposed. There's a big difference between what Hume is saying and what Rousseau is saying. And in principle, the king is subject to the laws of the people. Hume says, even talking about contract can get you put in jail. Rousseau is saying that the king is not necessarily the power. He's the power, then he's a tyrant, because he's not ruling according to the conventions and the mores. However, of course, since Rousseau knows people as they really are, he says that the people who oversee and enforce the law of the government become stronger they have their own interests, that can turn to abuse of power. How do you control the government? A huge problem for Americans, by the way, the general feeling of Americans is that America is great, the government is terrible. We think sort of how awful the controversies within the government are, but Americans have always done that, where the sausage is made inside the House of Representatives, that's where it all goes wrong. Because we're all Americans together. Why don't we get along? Why don't we just be able to participate in this great general will of our American society? Because the government. So ideally, the government is supposed to represent the general will, but as Rousseau says, it has its own shared self, and it may sacrifice the people for the government. So this means that the government can work against sovereignty just the way private will can work against the general will. Just the way all associations can work against the general will, because they have their own interests. So without corporate will to resist that, the government may oppress the sovereign, in other words, the general will, and destroy the social contract. So he says government naturally shrinks from democracy down to aristocracy and finally to royalty and to tyranny. It isn't the laws and the judges that give life, it's the power to legislate, which is constantly affirmed by its assemblies. And he also mentioned laws, like the laws given to us by the sacred fathers and the Constitution. Those laws are the ones that have the most power when we're on the laws. We feel that they make our society. Americans believe that the Constitution is really correct, the Bill of Rights, although very few of them can tell you what's in those laws. But vagueness is a bad virtue. So, he goes back to ancient times. He says, in Greece, the citizens gathered together in the Agora, and they said, we agree or we don't agree. So that was when they had assemblies, yes, where you can agree to the acts of law that the government has made. And he says, this pattern of gathering assemblies, this is voting. He's talking about voting. It's been 1750. So we can all vote. Everybody can vote in the assembly. And there should be periodic assemblies by date, as well as extraordinary assemblies when there's some big problem or something like that. And you shouldn't have assemblies unless it's sanctioned by law. This should be put in the law. The general will should will for assemblies, so the general will can manifest. During assemblies, executive power is suspended, and everybody can speak as equals. The prince hates this, because these assemblies can actually depose him. And they will try to prevent assemblies in every way they can. And citizens may be too lazy, too weak, too stupid to participate in assemblies. So the sovereignty weakens and the system falls. So citizens may prefer, he says, to serve with their wallets rather than their person. The state is near ruin. Personal service in exchange for money and leisure. Give money, and soon you will be in chains. In a strong state, public business takes precedence over private business. In fact, there is less private business to take care of since the state provides the most happiness. Again, as we come back to Greece. But when no one takes an interest in the state, domestic concerns predominate. We're going to find this in Tocqueville and in the political theory that we do. henceforth in this class. And Rousseau says, once someone says, what do I care about the affairs of state, the state should be considered lost. Loss of patriotism leads to the use of representatives. The populace has been free only at the moment when representatives are elected, otherwise enslaved. In other words, even if you vote, then you don't care whatever they do else. So democracy requires participation, and again, he said this may be enacted slaves with the washing machines. Modern people don't have slaves, Rousseau says again, they are slaves. So now he gets to some practical advice. How can we avoid this? Well, we should have very small cities where people can actually gather together. We should, because why? He says, the bigger the system, like if you have 10,000 people, then you're both 1 10,000, you have 100,000, you have 100,000. So the possibilities of variation become greater and greater and greater, and then this tends to break apart the society. The two technical problems of the contract. The ruler is not part of the social contract. He is an agent of the general. The executive is just the agent for the legislation. Only contract realizes is that people associate and make their own laws. The sovereign is the institutionalized base of that congregation will that then feeds back for us to understand what are our rules and laws. Now again, the prince, the ruler, will do everything he can to overcome this, because silence, punish, delay assemblies, this is the way government can subvert public authority. And again, periodic assemblies are a good idea. The assemblies basically have two basic, we have two propositions to consider. And ideally, it's silence. Everybody gathers together and moves along. The first question is, should the present form of government continue? Yes or no? The second question is, should the present administration remain in charge? Yes or no? After those are answered, if they're answered yes, then we go home. If they're answered no, then there has to be a debate and discussion about the present administration. Now I'm gonna shift gears because I'm running out of time. I've gotten to the end of the first part of book four now. And in this is the discussion that really led to Rousseau's banishment. This is the part that really, I mean, even though he's saying the king really doesn't rule the members by the will of the people, at least in the ideal state, which is saying that a king in our state is not just because he's not elected by the will of the people. So here he wants to talk about religion. Well, remember, you already said all states are founded originally on religion, on some deity. And then he talks about different kinds of religion that can be in a state. And I'm only going to talk about one, which is the one that was the most controversial, which is Christianity. Can Christianity be, this is gospel type of Christianity, where all human beings are brothers, sisters, This type of society. Yes. Religion of primitive Christianity. It's the one that it seems to be the best. All men are brothers. But the problem is, and magistrates would be honest. leaders would be just and incorruptible. Gospel Christianity has all of those virtues. However, it detaches people from the bonds of society in service to Jesus. What comes first? The general will or Jesus? Well, Jesus comes first. The society of Christians will no longer be a society of men. And as perfect, since it's perfect, it would not be any kind of binding general will. Certainly Christians, as I said, would do their duty. But the magistrate and the incorruptible and citizens would not fear death. But the kingdom of Christians is not of this world. The duty is only to fulfill God's command not to desert the state. So Christians are not really interested in the state, except insofar as the state permits them to practice. So long as the Christian has nothing to reproach himself for, in other words, not a sinner, then all is well, however the state is. Plus, he said, if there's even one man who's not a good Christian, he can easily deceive others who do not think ill of their fellows. If he becomes a ruler, in other words, if there's a bad ruler, God wills it. They should not revolt and spill blood, but meekly submit. What difference does it make whether one is a free man or a serf in this veil of tears? The essential thing is getting to heaven. The Christian army, he said, would know how to die better than how to be victorious. Providence rules. You cannot withstand the assault of men fired by ardent love of country. But really, there's no use, he says, in even considering the virtue and problems of a Christian. It does not exist. Christianity preaches only servitude and dependency. Its spirit is too favorable to tyranny, for tyranny not to take advantage of it at all times. Christians are made to be slaves. So the basic principles of the social contract. So each man is free so long as no harm is done to others. This is what we really need. And the state that he's talking about is a kind of civic religion. All citizens can have their own opinions so long as those opinions are not hostile to the state. And the fate of the person in the afterlife is of no concern to the state. You believe whatever you want to believe, but you cannot believe in something where you would not defend the state, where you wouldn't obey the laws of the state, where you wouldn't obey the laws that were put in place by the general, by your fellow citizen, and put into practice. If you do, you then can be punished. And it's a just punishment because the main thing that permits you to be in your religion, is the protection of the state. So if the dogma of the religion makes a person unsociable and unable to love the laws and justice of the state, unable to sacrifice life and service, then they can be banished. Or even put to death. So, the Christian, he says, would have great difficulty living in peace with those people that they would understand. Muslims. Those who hate God would be punished. Now the dogma of the religion that he wants to put in the society he wants has to be a much simpler religion. It's very simple. You believe a God, it's beneficial, who perhaps gave the laws originally, or just verified and validated the laws. You have to have some kind of emotion into the afterlife, the happiness of the just, punishment for the wicked, and the sanctity of the social contract. That's crucial. When I went to school, we had the flag and we had the cross. So there's only one negative dogma in the state, which is intolerance. intolerance has a bad effect. You know, it destroys the general. Everybody can't participate. Intolerance. So theological intolerance, the priests can become masters and kings their officers. I'm gonna now just say a little bit about what happened to Rousseau. After Emile and the social contract, he was exiled and wandered around like he did when he was a kid, from different place to place. He, many people loved and admired him and took him in, but he got more and more difficult to handle. And he felt he was, and he had, when people knew who he was, people were throwing rocks at his car and things like that. His paranoia was even paranoid at enemies. So he spent the rest of his life relatively isolated and keeping some kind of anonymity. And he wrote a lot of autobiography. He wrote his great book, The Confessions, which is the first great unexpurgated autobiography. He tells all the bad things that he did and how ashamed he was of them. He had perverted sexual preferences. He did nasty things to people. And he then says, okay, I am a human being. I'm going to present myself to you in all my feelings. And can you say that you can do this? In other words, like I said, he's the first person to make a virtue of his vices. You know, it's the first confession. It's the first time that you have an anti-hero. He's not a person of greatness. He's a person of like badness. But he recognizes badness, and then he presents it to you honestly, straightforwardly. His other great book, I think, that I used to read, it's called Memories of a Solitary Walker. It's really, really great. And that was, I think, his last book. He ends his life as a solitary walker. Alone, he says, fearful, he says. His quote is, I no longer have any neighbors, fellow men, or brothers in this world. It is only in myself that I find consolation, hope, and peace in mind. Let me give myself over to the only solace man cannot take away from me, conversing with my own soul. So he's given up on the possibility of men becoming good. He knows he's not good, but at least he can look within, and he can find through reverie and dream the kind of mystic. So even though he was very skeptical about the possibility of stable and just society, his thought on the ideal republic had a tremendous influence, not least right here over here. Popular democracy, universal voting, equality under the law for all citizens, the notion that the will of the people is sacred and is expressed through legislation that must be obeyed, social contract. So when you read it, the Declaration of Independence, notice that Rousseau was hugely, hugely influential. At the same time, his approval of the great legislator could easily be seen as the precursor of the triumph of Hitler and Stalin, the dictators, who say, I am the general. General will is me. This is not a real surprise because restless Rousseau, the most conflicted, the most ambitious, the least idealistic, the most passionate, the least practical, and I could go on and on, those controversies, contradictions. He remains an enigma today, which is part of the reason it makes him so fascinating. He died in 1778, age 66. In 1794, after the French Revolution, he was hailed as a secular saint, and his body was moved to the Pantheon, and remains today. Harmless, at peace, the wanderer and troublemaker, emotionless at last. On his deathbed, a visitor remarked that men are evil. Rousseau responded, men are evil, but man is good. So that's the best I can do.
document in the chapter.
Yeah, so it would be so lean. Yes, please ask any questions and we'll try to. Yeah.
So you said that he grew up like within Calvinism, but did he actually believe Calvinism at all?
He came back to Calvinism, but then he was eventually expelled from the Calvinist church because of his.
Okay.
I don't know, this is the question, but he certainly believed in original sin.
Yeah.
And he certainly believed in the possibility of redemption.
Because, like, don't Calvinists believe in predestiny pretty much entirely?
They believe in, yeah, but you don't know what it is. So
right.
You can't know where you're going, so it means everything is up to you. Mm-hmm. So they certainly didn't believe in the divine things or any of that. Mm-hmm. Quite a long, very well in small democratic society. And, of course, his own guilt and his feelings of, self-laceration were part of the Calvinist thing. You can always be looking inside yourself and trying to find out whether you like or whether you like to achieve. So I guess part of his torture and also part of his greatness is he's always trying to go beyond it. You know? So yeah, I think partly the strong, punitive religion with its great emphasis on personality and the community, the collective membership in the congregation, which was central to Calvinism. He says Calvin in Geneva was like a god. He was a great emphasis. There's so many things you can look at in politics. Can a state as large as this survive? Mm-hmm. You know, and is it because each state has different laws and rules that makes it possible? Rousseau gives a little aside. He said, I was going to talk about confederacies, but I don't have the time. So, yes, looking at the potentials and the kind of ways that good is understood, those provide for debates that actually have. I think you can do a lot with this if you want to. Just trying to look at different sorts of controversy that exist, how people are trying to say that where is the general rule? It's the sacred beginnings of our society, that's where it comes from. But then again, that was open and open.
But Rousseau believed that democracies change and develop.
Yes, and he believed that human beings also can change, that the actual nature of human beings will change if they're in a society which is just, which is governed by the human being. So they'll move themselves more toward the human being as they participate in the society. Just try to get a taste, because the terminology is difficult. The actual basic idea is pretty strict. We can give it to you.
Studying the subject is wrong. Here's why I recommend it. It was more of like, here's a camera.